So we are going to see today Introduction to Anatomy and its terms. So let's start. So anatomy is defined as study of body structures and relationship among structures. We are going to see a lot of body structures in the anatomy classes. Basically, anatomy is seeing the body structures and the relationship among structures. So how one structure is related to the other structure. So that is what you're going to see. So, you know, and your body has a lot of structures, right? So you'll see. So the meaning of anatomy is cutting up. So it has come from Greek word. So whenever you see anatomical terms, you'll see that they have derived from either Greek or Latin. Okay. So terms may be a little difficult for you guys in the initial time, but you will cope up. So the meaning is cutting up. So you can see here a picture here where you can see a body is dissected. And you can see a lot of muscles here which are placed. Right? And it is one of the foundation of medicine. So whichever course you take in medicine, from MBBS to nursing, you will see anatomy as the basic subject. Now let's see the subdivisions of anatomy. So anatomy can be studied in different subheadings. The first one is cadaveric anatomy. So cadaveric anatomy, as we have seen in the previous picture, here, what you can see here is a human body, right? And this is called as cadaver. And this is used for anatomy teaching. So we can dissect the body and see what it is there inside. That is called as a cadaveric anatomy. So we are studying the cadaver and we learn anatomy. So it is taught by theory lectures followed by dissection. Usually, a theory class will be taken prior to the dissection. So this procedure where you do the, where you open up the body is called as dissection. Usually, dissection is followed by a theory class. In a sense, I'll give an example. Suppose we are going to study about liver. You know, liver, right? So, a liver, what is liver and how it is placed, where it is placed? There will be a theory class followed by a practical class where you will see the original liver, right? So, that is regarding this study, cadaveric study. Cadaveric study itself is divided into two parts or two methods are there to study cadaveric anatomy. First one is regional anatomy. In regional anatomy, we will see anatomy in different parts. So your body has been divided into different parts like head and neck, thoracic region, abdominal region, okay, then upper limb, lower limbs. In the head and neck, we have brain. So this is called as regional anatomy. You study anatomy according to regions. So that is one method. Other method is systemic anatomy. Now, what do you mean by systemic anatomy? Here we study a system. So it is a study of structures of organ systems, such as skin, integumental system, that is skin, skeletal system, where you study about the bones, muscular system, where you study about the muscles, cardiovascular system, where you study about the heart, blood vessels, lymphatic system, again you study about a lymphatic system like lymphatic vessels, lymph nodes, etc. Nervous system, you study about the brain, nerves, endocrine system, you read about a lot of endocrine glands that you have. Respiratory system, where you study about nose, you know, pharynx, trachea, lungs, and so on. Digestive system, which consists of, it starts from mouth, right? Esophagus, your stomach, intestines, etc. Urinary system, which consists of kidney, urinary bladder, ureter, all those things. Reproductive system, which consists of, you have male and female reproductive system, which consists of a lot of organs. So these are two methods of studying anatomy. So mostly we will be going for the first method, that is regional anatomy. where we take a part initially, or say we take upper limb and we study about the upper limb, everything about the upper limb, the bones of the upper limb, the muscles of the upper limb, the nerves, the vessels of the upper limb, and so on. Okay, so we usually prefer the first method, that is regional anatomy. The other method is living anatomy. Now we are going to study anatomy in a living person. How to do that? There are two methods to do this. One is surface anatomy, other one is medical imaging. So surface anatomy and medical imaging are the two approaches for living anatomy. First one is surface anatomy. So it is a study of external features of the body of an animal. So externally, what you can see, that is what is called as surface anatomy. It deals with anatomical features that can be studied by sight without dissection. Here, we are not going to dissect. That means we are not going to open up. But without opening the body, we can assume that there are some organs which are placed in this area, in so and so area. For example, you know, this area we have lungs. This area again we have lungs, right lung, left lung. So similarly, there are organs. Here you have liver, isn't it? So that is a study which is called as surface anatomy, also called as topographic anatomy. So this is one method of studying anatomy in a living person. Now look at this picture. You can see that there are a lot of points which are mentioned here. You can see this point. Here this point is mentioning, this point is called as McBurney's point. McBurney's point, which represents appendix. Okay. So this is very useful in case of appendicitis, where you get inflammation of appendix. So you can palpate this area and apply pressure on this area. If the patient has appendicitis, the patient will have tenderness on this point. So this is the use of surface anatomy. So we are actually assuming the organs in a living person. This can be done only if you know anatomy. Otherwise, you cannot exactly point at this place. So this is one method of studying anatomy. The next method is medical imaging. So medical imaging, you can see here, this picture. It is a computerized tomography. A patient is undergoing computerized tomography. Then there are other methods like sonography, radiography. I think you'll be very familiar with radiography, X-rays. And the next branch in anatomy is called embryology. Embryology. So it deals with an individual from conception to adult form. So how you're born, what are the stages of your development in the womb? So this has been done in embryology. And the next one is histology. Histology, you basically see cells, tissues with the use of microscope. So you use microscope and you study the cells, or study at the level of tissue level. Anatomy, we are dealing with the level of tissue level or cell level, that is histology. So am I audible?
Yes sir.
So this is regarding histology. So you need to know about microscope, you need to know how to prepare the slides. You can see here one structure here, that is the slide which is kept on this tissue is mount. So you need to know all these things. And the next method or next wing of anatomy is applied anatomy. Now we are going to apply the knowledge of anatomy into a patient so that you can better diagnose and treat the patient. So this is done in practice of medicine. So if you know better anatomy, you can better practice medicine. The next division is genetics. Genetics is, you know what is genetics, right? It actually it's a branch of anatomy which deals with genes, and it will exactly tell you how you are like this or how your behaviors are developed from generation to generation. So that is done. This study is done in genetics. Now we will see a little bit regarding history of anatomy. So let's see. So Hippocrates is called as father of medicine. So father of medicine is Hippocrates. And Herophilus is called as father of anatomy. So this is Herophilus. You can see in this side. And here's the first person to dissect human body. So anatomy is complete only when you do dissection. So that has been started by Herophilus. So he's been called as father of anatomy. Muntinus, he is an Italian. He is called as restorer of anatomy. Anatomia is a book which is first example of modern dissection manual. So here, a book, Anatomia, is written by Muntinus, which says how to dissect the human body. So we have dissection manual that we follow now, but they are different. They are called as Cunningham manual of dissection. But this is the first one, which is called as Anatomia. Vesalius is called as founder of modern anatomy. So modern anatomy father is Vesalius. He has written a book called De Fabricia Humani Corporis. You can see this book here, Anatomia. Anatomia is here, written by Muntinus. So these are some of the great pioneers of anatomy. When looking towards the history of anatomy, it has probably started early with examination of sacrifice victims. So whatever victims are there, their body is to be examined to study about what is inside the body in the initial time. And it is first documented by Egyptians, dated back to 1600 BC. And their books, Egyptian anatomical papyrus, which shows the blood vessels. So that means it's a proof that they were studying about the structures within the human body. Now coming to the 19th century, here in Europe, a place called Edinburgh, where medical students has to do dissection. If they want to study medicine, it's made compulsory that they have to do dissection. So it is made compulsory in a university. So it has happened in 19th century. I'm just telling you the history. So what happened was that those times, getting cadaver or the dead body was too difficult. Of course, now also we have difficulty in getting cadaver. But that time it was more difficult. So what happened was two people called Burke and Hare, what they did, they used to kill the people and they used to bring the dead bodies to a doctor. It's called Robert. So he used to pay money to Burke and Hare. So what they used to do, they used to just kill the people for the cadaver, for the dead body, and they used to sell it to Dr. Robert. And he used to use that bodies for the dissection. So you can just think of the scarcity of the bodies that they had in 19th century. So later they were arrested. These three were arrested. So I just told you an interesting story in the history of anatomy. So people have to kill the other people to get the cadaver. Now coming to the anatomical position. So you need to know, this is a basic thing in anatomy. We describe all the structures in anatomy in relation to anatomical position. So here you can see how a person is standing here. Right, here also you can see one person standing. So let's see how we can define anatomical position. So this is one of the basic thing of anatomy. So the relationship of the various parts and organs of the body keep changing because you can move, right? So because of the movement that you can do, the relationship of one structure with other structure may change. In other words, you can change your body parts, isn't it? Your upper limb can be rotated, your upper limb can be moved to back, upper limb can be moved to front. No, you can do all those things. So we need to define the structures. We cannot define a structure when it is in a constant movement, right? So we need to define the structures in anatomy by keeping it in a stable position. So that is called as anatomical position. So how to do that? So let's see how to do that. So we need to have a fixed position to explain the structures. So this is a position. Body is standing upright. So the person has to stand upright. Eyes are looking directly forwards. So eyes should be looking directly forwards. As you can see here, the upper limbs. These are called as limbs. Upper limbs. Upper limbs. So upper limbs are hanging by side. And the palm facing forward. So you can see here, this is the palm. Under the palm. Okay, I'll tell you the positions, I mean the names later, but this is palm, this is facing forwards. Lower limbs are parallel with feet directed forwards. Mm-hmm. As you can see here, this is feet, this is lower limb, as you can see here. So the feet is directing forwards, and the lower limbs are parallel with each other. So this is the anatomical position of the body. So once again, the person is standing upright. Eyes are looking forwards, upper limbs are hanging by sides, the palm facing forwards, lower limbs are parallel with each other, where the feet is facing or directed forwards. Now there are other positions as well. This position is called supine. This is posterior view or Sims view, where you can see the lower limb. One lower limb is extended, other one is flexed. Here you can see prone position. This is knee chest position. This is dorsal recumbent position, standing position, sitting position, squatting position, lithotomy positions. So there are a lot of positions. We will see what are the importance of these positions. So this is supine position. So I think this is one of the favorite position, where you lie down. When a person is lying on his back or back, and the arms by sides, palms facing upwards,
and
putting together. So this is called as supine position. So it is like you're just lying down in a bed, where your back is resting back on the bed. And the prone position, it is just opposite to that of supine position, as you can see here, where your chest is facing the bed. Okay. And the next position that you can see here is lithotomy position. So that you can see here, a person is lying on the table, and you can see that the thighs are flexed. Let's see that. So person is lying on the back and feet supported in straps. Here you can see that the feet's legs are up, thighs are flexed, and they are supported by the straps. So this is usually done, or this position is attained during the delivery of a baby. So in case of parturition, this position is done in case of normal delivery. Now coming to the anatomical planes. So there are a lot of planes which are explained in anatomy. So they are median plane. So this is median plane. As you can see, it is passing exactly to the center of the body, right? Sagittal plane. Here is sagittal plane. I'm just showing you the planes here. I'll explain. Coronal plane. Coronal plane is this one. This is coronal plane. Transverse plane. This is transverse plane. We have seen some planes like median plane, sagittal plane, then coronal plane. You can see how it is dividing, coronal plane, how it is dividing the body. Then this is transverse plane. Let's see in detail these planes. So the first one, median plane. So it's an imaginary plane that divides the body into two equal halves. So this plane divides the body into two halves. So these halves are right and left halves. The next plane, that is sagittal plane. This is sagittal plane. We can see that sagittal plane is parallel to your median plane. So median plane is exactly passing through the center, whereas sagittal plane is not passing through the center, but you can see it is parallel to median plane. The next plane is coronal plane. Coronal plane can be seen here, which is mentioned here as YZ. Here it passes through the body at right angle to median plane, but what it does is going to divide the body into anterior and posterior half. Anterior and posterior half. Let's see. I'll tell you what does exactly that coronal plane in the next slide. Transverse plane. This is transverse plane. This is transverse plane, which passes through the body at right angle to median and coronal plane. So what it does, it divides the body into upper and lower part. As you can see here, this is transverse plane. Now we are going to describe everything in detail. So median plane, or it's also called as mid sagittal plane. So this is median plane. So this is passing through the center of the body, dividing it into right and left equal halves. So that is your median plane. Coming to the next plane, that is sagittal plane. Sagittal plane usually passes parallel to your median plane. As you can see here, this is sagittal plane. But it is not passing through the center. It may be passing through the other parts of the body. As you can see, it is passing through the side of the body now, but it is parallel to your median plane. Next plane is coronal plane. Here you can see very clearly, this is the coronal plane. This one is the coronal plane, as you can see here. What it does? It is passing through the body, which divides the body into two halves, anterior and posterior half. So this, what you can see here, this is the anterior aspect of the body, and what you can see behind, back of the body, that is called as posterior part. So basically, coronal plane is this one, which divides the body into anterior part, or the front part, and the back part. Front is called as anterior, back side of the body is called as posterior. You will see anatomical terms. Transverse plane, this is transverse plane, as you can see here. This one, what it does, this plane passing through the center of the body here, but it is perpendicular to your sagittal plane and coronal plane, and divides the body into upper half and a lower half. So that is called as transverse plane, which divides the body into upper and lower half. So coronal plane is dividing the body into anterior part and a posterior part. Transverse plane is dividing into upper and lower part. Now coming to the terms of anatomy. Here, a lot of terms are used in anatomy. So let's see one by one. Proximal. Proximal means it is nearer to the attachment of a limb to trunk. Now look at this here. This is the trunk. This area is called as a trunk, which includes two parts, thorax and the abdomen. So this is trunk. Okay. And what are limbs? These are limbs. Upper limb, lower limbs. So we are going to see this term, proximal. That means nearer to attachment of a limb to trunk. So let's see here. I'm going to put two points here. One, this here, another point here. Now there are two points, one here and one here. And I'm going to tell that this point is point A, this is point B. Now I'm going to tell that point A is proximal to point B. Or point A is proximal. Point A is the proximal point, and point B is distal point. Now what is distal? Distal means it is further away from attachment of a limb to trunk. That means, again, I'm explaining that, putting a point here, A and B, and I'm telling that A is proximal and B is distal. B is distal. So this is a trunk, and this is the attachment of the limb to the trunk. So it defines how far a point is from the attachment of the trunk. So point A, point B. Point A is proximal, point B is distal. Now again, let's imagine one point I'm putting here, C, in the hand. Now look at this here. This is most distal. The point C is most distal, and point A will be remaining as a proximal point. And now point B here will be in between. Right, so that is called as proximal and distal points, which are related to the limbs. How far the structure in the limb is away from the trunk. Now, another point, medial. What is medial? Medial means a structure nearer to the median plane. Now look at this here. This is the median plane, which we already described, median plane or mid-sagittal plane. Now, again, let's put two points here. One point here, which can be called as A, the second point here, B. So we are putting two points, one A and one B. Now, this says how far a structure from a median plane of the body. Now, let's see one more term here, lateral. Now, this also says a structure how further away from the median plane. Now, put this point, point A, point B. Now, point A is medial, point B is lateral. Why point A is medial? Because A is nearer to the median plane. Why point B is lateral? Because it is away from the median plane. So that is how we say that you have medial point, which can be called as A here, and lateral point here, that can be called as B. So how far is away? That is lateral. How far it is near? That is medial. Fine. Now anterior and posterior. Anterior is this one. What you can see here? The front surface of the body is called as anterior. And what you can see behind? Here you cannot see, but here you imagine what is behind. That is the back surface of the body, that is posterior. So I think this is clear. Superior and inferior. Superior and inferior. Here, how the structure is related or how structure is away or near to the head. So depending upon that, we term it as superior or inferior. Now, if a structure is situated towards the head, we call it as superior. If a structure is situated towards the feet, we call it as inferior. So just imagine here, I'm going to put two points here, A, and one point here as B. Now, A is superior and B is inferior. So it is very simple. A is superior and B is inferior because B is very near to the feet or it is away from the head. So here you can see some terms which are used here. Anterior, also called as ventral. Anterior, also called as ventral. Posterior, called as dorsal. Similarly, superior is called as cephalic. Cephalic means head. And inferior is called as caudal. Caudal is meaning tail. So there are different terms which are used here. Now the next one is superficial and deep. Now superficial and deep. So superficial defines nearer to the surface of the body, and deep refers how deep it is inside the body. I'll tell you an example. The skin that you can see, skin is superficial structure. Skin is a superficial structure. But when you talk about the heart or the lungs, they are deep. So superficial is seen with the superior surface or superficial surface of the body, whereas deep structures are placed deep within the body. So that's the difference between superficial and deep. So I think it is clear. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine.
So, yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm just repeating this term because you know this is very important in anatomy. So let's revise this once again. So proximal, the meaning is how nearer this is a point is to the trunk. So now here I'm putting point A and point B, and I'm saying point A is proximal because it is near to the trunk, and point B is distal. Similarly, medial, lateral. Now how it is related to the median plane, how the structure is related to the median plane, depending on that we say medial and lateral. Now point A here is medial. If I'm putting a point here, that is lateral. Okay, and the next one is anterior and posterior. Anterior, what you can see here, this is ventral surface, anterior surface. What you can see here, what you can see backside, that is dorsal surface. Superior and inferior. Superior, how it is related to the head. So if I'm putting a point here at this point, and if I'm putting a point here, I'm saying that point A is superior and point B is inferior. So that's what. Now coming to superficial and deep. Superficial, it is nearer to the surface of the body. I said skin is superficial, but the heart, the lungs, the stomach, the organs, they are deep. Now there are some other terms. As you can see here, you can variable C, the proximal. This point is, you can see the upper limb here. You are seeing the hand. You can see this point here. This is proximal. And this point, if I'm putting a point here, that is distal. So towards this is proximal and this side is distal. Now, similarly, there are other terms which can be used in some areas. Like I said, this is a hand. Hand, this surface, the ventral surface of the hand is called as palmar surface. The opposite surface, the back surface of the hand is called as dorsal surface. So we use some terms, anatomical terms for some particular structures. So this is an example here, hand, palmar surface or palm of the hand, and opposite side is dorsum of the hand. Now the other terms, in the foot, this area is foot. Okay, so this area is called as dorsum of the foot, dorsum of the foot. And this area where you stand, that is called as bottom of the foot, and also called as sole of the foot. So we have dorsal surface of the foot or dorsum of the foot or top of the foot. Here, this area we call it as plantar surface of the foot, bottom of the foot, sole of the foot. So there are different terms which can be used. So plantar surface. So here it was palmar surface. Okay, so look at that. Right. Now coming to the movements. So we are going to define some movements here. See that. So this movement that you can see here, I think you might be doing it. So this is flexion. So you can see what happens in flexion. And you can see here an extension. Let's define how it is. Flexion and extension.
So
what is flexion? So flexion can be defined as bending of parts of body in sagittal plane. So we are going to bend some parts of the body in sagittal plane. You know what is sagittal plane, right? So you have to imagine this in an anatomical position. So imagine that you are standing in anatomical position and you are going to do, so let's say the flexion. Now this area, what this area is called as a flexor surface or the anterior surface of the body, right? Anterior surface in anatomical position. So let's define that. This picture is not enough. Let me give you some other picture. Yeah, here. Look at this. So how will you define the flexion? Flexion is defined as when two flexor surface or when the two flexor surface, they come in contact with each other. Now look at this hand, upper limb. Here, this is an anatomical position. Now this is flexor surface, right? And the chest, you can see, this is flexor surface. Now when the arm is moving to the front, where you can see flexor surface of the arm, this is arm, okay, this is forearm, this is hand. Okay, I'll tell you some terms here, arm, forearm, hand. And what you can see here is a chest, right? Chest, the anterior surface of the chest. I said this is a trunk. Trunk has got two parts, chest and abdomen. So what happens in this moment? The anterior surface of the arm is coming in contact with the anterior surface of the chest. This type of movement is called as flexion. Flexion. Okay. And look at this here. Here you can see this is anterior surface of the forearm. This is anterior surface of your arm. So when you do this movement at the elbow, that is called as flexion. Here, this movement is done in the shoulder joint, flexion. So movements can happen in different joints. So, but the basic thing that you should know is plantar flexion is, flexion is defined as a movement of the joint where two flexor surface comes close to each other. As you can see here, this is flexor surface, this is flexor surface. They are coming in close with each other. So that is flexion. There's a term which is used in the foot, which is called as dorsiflexion. This is only used in the ankle joint. You know, this is ankle joint. Ankle joint where you can move the foot. So here, dorsiflexion. Dorsiflexion is bending at ankle joint. So this movement You can see here the arrow. This is a neutral position of the foot. If it is, if you are moving your foot upwards, that is called as dorsiflexion. Dorsiflexion. And when you hear what happens, the dorsum of the foot and the front surface of the leg, they come close with each other in dorsiflexion. So dorsiflexion is only possible, or it is a term which is used at the angle joint. This is an angle joint. Okay. So this movement is called as dorsiflexion. So the opposite movement, the reverse of dorsiflexion, is called as plantar flexion. Here, this is the neutral position of the foot. Now you are going to move your foot downwards inferiorly. That is called as plantar flexion. Or you can see the movement is towards the plantar surface of the foot. I said, what is plantar surface of the foot? Here you can see dorsiflexion. The movement is towards, right? Dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. This happens in the ankle joint. So dorsiflexion is when you do to move your foot superiorly. That is your dorsiflexion. And this movement, the opposite movement of dorsiflexion, is called as plantar flexion. Or you can define in this way. Dorsiflexion, this is a neutral position of the foot. Dorsiflexion is the movements of the foot towards the dorsum of the foot. Whereas plantar flexion is the movement of the foot towards the plantar surface of the foot. You can see here the flexion here. Flexion in the arm. This is the anterior surface of the arm. This is the anterior surface of the chest. When this movement happens, they are coming in close with each other. That is flexion. Similarly, look at your knee joint. This is a knee joint, and this is the leg. Okay, there are different terms like this is the lower limb, where you can see thigh, leg, and foot. Okay, I mentioned here also. This is arm, forearm, hand. This is thigh, leg, foot. Now look at this. What happens here is that here the flexor surface are coming in contact with each other. You can see when you bend your knee, that is called flexion. Look at this here. See, this is a neutral position. When you do this at the elbow joint, that is flexion. You do the opposite movement at the elbow joint, that is extension. Look at this here. In the wrist joint, this is a wrist joint. This is a forearm. This is a hand. The joint here is wrist joint. This movement is, this is neutral position. This movement is flexion. And the opposite movement is extension. Now look at this here. This is a neutral position of the fingers. So flexion and extension happens in all the joints, right? So look at this here. Neutral position. Now when you do this movement, flexion. When you come to the normal position, neutral position, that is called as extension. So this is flexion, this is extension, and you can do this movement, which is called as hyperextension. Hyperextension. Hyperextension is possible in fingers. Okay, this is a neutral position. This is hyperextension. Coming back to the normal position is extension. Now we'll define extension. Already we have seen, coming to extension, here extension also takes place in sagittal plane. So you should remember what is sagittal plane. I already mentioned sagittal plane. Sagittal plane is a plane which is parallel to your median plane, right? So here angle of the joint increases so that two extensor surface comes close to each other. Look at this here. This is elbow joint. Now we have seen. So let's see here. This is the angle of the joint. Now see the flexion. The angle of the joint is reduced in the flexion, right? But when you do the opposite movement, extension, what happens? The angle of the joint, it becomes more. So in simple words, you can define flexion and extension, where you can define flexion like the angle of the joint is reduced here in the flexion, whereas in the extension, the angle of the joint is increased, right? So that is another method of defining flexion and extension. So this happens in the elbow joint. Flexion extension. Here also we have seen extension, this one, and here you have seen the extension. This is extension, and this is extension in the hand, right? Fine. So flexion at the elbow and extension at elbow joint. Look at this here. Now the hand, look at this here, this area, I mean the flexion is not shown here, but if this person is flexing here his arm, it would be here, right? Now going back towards it, extension, towards the normal position, extension. Look at this here. Now this movement is extension. Opposite movement is flexion. The next movement, that is abduction. Abduction. Look at this. Abduction occurs when a part of the body moves away from the median plane. So imagine here, this is the median plane. Now, look at this hand here. It was here, but when it tries to move this way, that means now the upper limb is moving away from the median plane. That is called as abduction. Abduction. You can see here, abduction. So abduction. Then if it is coming close, this movement opposite way, that is called as adduction. Adduction. Okay, so here we are going to see two terms, abduction and adduction. Abduction is moving away from the median plane, part of the body which is moving away from the median plane, that is abduction. But if the opposite movement happens, that is adduction. Adduction. Okay, so abduction and adduction. Now let's see more about abduction. Now abduction also can happen in joints. Now look at it. Regarding the fingers, this is the axis. Okay, axis, the median axis that is passing through here, the axis of the abduction, that abduction adduction that passes through the third finger, or you can say that the third finger is already adducted. The third finger is adducted in a normal position or the neutral position. The third finger is adducted. Now when we define the abduction of the fingers, if the finger is moving away from this plane, that is called as abduction. Now look at this here. You can see this is a normal neutral position of the fingers. Now, when this finger is trying to move away from the axis, that is called as abduction of this finger. Similarly, here, look at this here. This finger, if it is moving away from the plane or the axis, that is called as abduction. Similarly, the little finger, which is also moving away from the axis here, that is abduction. So here, the axis is passing through the third finger, any movement away from it, other fingers, right? This is called as abduction. Similarly, look at this here. This is regarding the foot. The axis is passing through the second toe. Now, the hallux, the big toe, if it is moving this way, this is called as abduction, as you can see in the figure. And this finger, the third toe, if it is moving in this way, that is called as abduction. So here you have to remember one thing. Here the axis in the hand passes through the third finger, or you can say the third finger is already adducted position. Now when we define the fingers, the abduction of the other fingers, any movement of the finger which can be away from this plane is called as abduction. So it is this way, abduction here, whereas in the other side we can see this finger is moving to this area, that is your abduction. Similarly, look at this lower limb, the foot, the axis is passing through the second toe here. Now, any movement away from this, so or you can say that the second toe is already in adducted position. Now the big toe, when it is moving towards this side, that is abduction. The third toe, if it is moving to the opposite side or away from the axis, that is called as abduction. Now, just imagine the opposite movement in the foot. Now, if the big toe is moving towards the axis, look at this here. That is called as adduction. Look at this, other fingers. They are going to move towards this axis. That is called as adduction. So, abduction and adduction are opposite. So, I think it is clear. Here, only thing you should remember that the axis, which is passing through the third finger in the hand and second toe in the foot. So I already explained this. Now coming to adduction. So already explained adduction also. So adduction occurs when the part of the body moves towards the median plane. So if this upper limb is trying to move towards the median plane. So median plane is here. That is called as adduction. Adduction. So adduction and abduction are opposite to each other. Now here look at this. Abduction, adduction. Again, the axis is the same, right? You can see here. This is the third finger. A finger trying to move towards this position, adducted position. Now here, this is abducted. When it is trying to move this way, that is adduction, right? I said already explained here. Look at this here. This is the axis. So if the big toe is trying to come towards the axis, that is adduction. If this toe, it is abducted here, but in this, you can see it is detected. So this is the different movements that can happen in hand and the foot. Okay, abduction is also possible in other joints that we will see as we go through. Now another term which is used again in the foot, we already saw that dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. Now there is one more movement, that is inversion and eversion. Look at this here, inversion and eversion. Now I already mentioned that here this is the dorsum of the foot, and what you can see below, that is the sole of the foot. So this is the dorsum and this is the sole of the foot. Now how will you define inversion? Inversion can be defined as the movement of the foot where you can see the sole of the foot is facing medially or towards the median plane, right? Towards the median plane. Or you can also see that, because there are two borders of the foot. This is medial border of the foot, medial border because it is towards the big toe. So we call it as medial border. And this is lateral border. Okay, I think this person, we are seeing the left lower limb, right? Left lower limb. So this is medial, and this is lateral. Why is it medial? Because it is towards the median plane. Why is it lateral? Because it is away from the median plane. So I'm just defining this term, inversion and eversion. Inversion, you can see the sole of the foot faces medially. Sole of the foot faces medially. Eversion, you can see the sole of the foot faces laterally. Or in other terms, you can say in inversion, the medial border is elevated. Medial border is elevated. Or in eversion, you can see the lateral border is elevated in comparing with the medial border. So that is the difference here. So inversion and eversion. Okay. I hope it's clear. So sole of the foot. Yeah. Sole of the foot faces medial, that is inversion. And eversion, sole of the foot faces laterally. So that is this movement here. This also happens in foot. You should remember that.